When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven!" Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple, and when he had looked around at everything as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. On the following day, when they came from Bethany, he was hungry. Seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to see whether perhaps he would find anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. He said to it, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." His disciples heard it. Then they came to Jerusalem. And he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling and those who were buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. He was teaching and saying, "Is it not written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations,' but you have made it a den of robbers?" And when the chief priests and the scribes heard it, they kept looking for a way to kill him, for they were afraid of him, because the whole crowd was spellbound by his teaching. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I've often thought that the processional music for Palm Sunday should sound more like this. Sense of foreboding. If you think of the old westerns, a stranger rides into town. And at the end of the story, the town is better off because the stranger came in and got rid of the bad guys. But for that to happen, the status quo needs to be shaken up. The new guy rides into town, and everybody's life is going to be different. Well, the sense of foreboding in today's gospel story is especially real to us because we know how the story continues. The happy hosannas of Palm Sunday so quickly turn into the curses of "crucify him" on Good Friday. It's almost inconceivable that Jesus enters the city of Jerusalem to such fanfare and adulation only to be led out of the city 5 days later, bearing a cross. How could Jesus go so quickly from popular hero to hated pariah? How could he go from having his face brushed with palm branches to having his face bloodied with thorns? The cheering of the crowds on Palm Sunday was understandable. So many of these people from Jerusalem and Galilee had been spellbound by Jesus' teaching. He taught with such authority, and many of these people had witnessed his miracles, or had certainly heard of this man, giving sight to the blind, even raising Lazarus from the dead. Many believed that Jesus was Israel's Messiah, and that's why they cry, Hosanna, which means, save us now. So it's easy to see why the crowds would cheer Jesus. But why, 5 days later, would the crowds jeer Jesus? Well, maybe the crowd that cheered Jesus on Palm Sunday is an entirely different group of people from the crowd that jeered Jesus on Good Friday. The Palm Sunday crowd may have been largely consisted of common people who were truly Jesus' fans. The Good Friday crowd could have been a very different bunch. The chief priests, religious leaders, and possibly even people bribed by Jesus' enemies to be part of that angry mob. So maybe the people waving their palm branches might not be as fickle as we've often believed them to be. But the fact is, us human beings can be so frighteningly fickle. And very few things can flip that switch in our hearts as much as when Jesus challenges us where we are comfortable. When the Lord confronts things in our lives that we have invested so much into maintaining. After Jesus arrives in Jerusalem, he goes to the temple, the center of religious life. And in an episode his disciples could never forget, an incident so viscerally impactful that it's included in all four of the Gospels, Jesus chases out those who are buying and selling in the temple courts, turning over tables and benches, doves probably flying everywhere. And we often conclude that Jesus is condemning commercialism or even morally questionable business tactics. But before we jump to this conclusion, remember that those people at the tables in the temple courts were supposed to be there. Somebody had to be there in the temple selling doves for the good religious folks to make their required offerings of doves that was prescribed way back in Exodus. Money changers, they were supposed to be there because Jewish law said that Roman coins were impure, an abomination to the Lord, and so they would not be acceptable offerings in the temple. So the Roman coins had to be exchanged for a special temple currency that had been consecrated for holy use. The money changers and the merchants were supposed to be there in the temple courts. They had been part of the temple culture from the time when the temple was rebuilt 500 years earlier. Jesus had been to the temple many times before, so why does he unleash his righteous anger now? You see, in casting out the money changers and throwing over the temples just a few days before he was crucified, Jesus is dramatically announcing that the old way of making sacrifices is ending. The once and for all sacrifice that he will be offering himself on the cross will usher in a whole new way of relating to God, a whole new way of worshiping, essentially a whole new way of life. Now, a church consultant would probably have told Jesus to find a more gentle way of introducing change. But for Jesus, this is not really about changing people's practices. Jesus cares about changing people's hearts. And the greatest barrier to a new heart, a heart alive with spiritual power and freedom, is our human tendency to cling to the safe and the predictable. And so we jump to fear and feeling threatened before even opening ourselves to the dynamic movement of God. Jesus confronts what may be the most insidious spirit of darkness, the pernicious spirit of religion. Now, hear me. Religion itself is a good thing. Religion is a wonderful way of living out our faith in community with others. But what we're talking about, what Jesus is confronting, is an unholy religious spirit that seeks to substitute religious activity for the power of a relationship with God. An unholy religious spirit, you see, wages war against the grace of God in our lives, convincing us again and again that we haven't done enough to earn God's forgiveness. An unholy religious spirit can also make us self-righteous to the extent that we appear often rigidly dogmatic and not simply a person of conviction. An unholy religious spirit can convince us that Christianity is basically about going to church on Sunday or participating in church activities. And so when the topic of spirituality comes up, we tend to talk more about our church involvement than about the way knowing Jesus has impacted our life. And this dangerous religious spirit places emphasis on the outward things associated with religion. Instead of focusing on the great commandment to love God with all our being and to focus on the second part of that great commandment, to love our neighbors as ourselves, to focus on the great commission to make disciples, an unholy spirit of religion back in Jesus' day and even today in the church gives more focus and energy and passion to things like church programs, dress codes, rituals, music styles, organizational structures, or even doctrinal positions. These unholy religious spirits dangerously allow good things to block us from God's best. And we don't like anyone messing with what seems good to us. My guess is that Jesus' public demonstration in the temple courts flipped the switch in the hearts of many of the people who were there in Jerusalem. They wanted Jesus to save them from what they didn't like about their life, not to challenge the things they did like. Why didn't Jesus go knock down some statue of Caesar or burn a few Roman chariots? Why is Jesus messing with the way we're used to practicing our religion? So when those who already reviled Jesus began to stir up the crowd on Good Friday, there's that image fresh in everybody's mind of Jesus messing up the temple. And in that instant, as the slithering serpent of self-preservation summoned up suspicion and resentment, lips would utter the words, "Crucify him." There's one more detail in this Palm Sunday text that points to this unholy spirit of religion that Jesus was confronting. On the way to the temple, Jesus sees a fig tree covered with leaves, and he looks to find if the tree had any fruit. And it was common in those days for travelers to take fruit from trees along the road. And when Jesus reached the tree, he found nothing but leaves. And the text tells us it was not the season for figs. And so we might think that Jesus is being unreasonable then to curse this tree for not producing figs in a season when figs would not be expected. But botanists tell us that fig trees in Palestine produce tiny edible figs in the spring. And these little buds signify that the tree is healthy and will produce fruit, full figs, that year. These tiny buds appear before the leaves appear. So Jesus sees a fig tree full of leaves, a tree that should have had these small edible figs to indicate a rich harvest of figs to come. But this fig tree, for all the leaves it had as an outward sign of vitality, offered no fruit for weary travelers and showed no hope of producing good fruit. Lots of leaves, but no fruit. Consider what the great English preacher Charles Spurgeon said of this episode. What a lesson this is to churches. There have been churches which have stood prominent in numbers and in influence, but faith and love and holiness have not been maintained, and the Holy Ghost has left them to the vain show of a fruitless profession. And there stand those churches with the trunk of organization and the widely extended branches, but they are dead, and every year they become more and more decayed. We may have numbers of people coming, Spurgeon said over 100 years ago. He said this, we may have numbers of people coming, but unless vital godliness is in our midst, what are congregations and churches? He said, we might have a valued ministry, but what would this be without the Spirit of God? We might have many outward efforts, but what of these without the Spirit of prayer? And then he said to his London congregation, and I think this word applies to us here and those of you that will soon be going back to other churches to consider. Spurgeon said, I dread lest we should ever come to be like a tree precocious with superlative profession, but yet worthless, because the vital union with Christ is gone. He said, may it never be so in this church. And I say amen to that. May it never be so with this church. And I also say, may it never be so in my life. May my life draw life from the true vine, Jesus Christ, and from that union may fruit come forth, life-giving fruit, not just nice-looking leaves. And may I cheer the Lord Jesus when he rides into town, but not only on that day when it is easy to cheer. May I cheer his lordship, even when he challenges the things that I hold dear for the sake of his kingdom, his power, and his glory. Amen.